This is a theorem due to Lowash and Simonovitz. Lowash is really one of the top theoretical computer scientists and mathematicians who has just contributed, has influenced almost every aspect of optimization and randomized algorithms we can think of. So he had a different way. I mean, it's actually elementary. He doesn't use any advanced concepts, but they had just a different way of analyzing random box. And one of the things we noticed, this peculiarity with the fact that if it's a bipartite graph, then I don't reach any stationary distribution, right? So one way to fix it often is you add self-loops. Once you add a self-loop to every node, then the graph is no longer bipartite. That's sort of the easiest way to get rid of bipartiteness. So another way to handle it is sometimes what is called lazy random walks, where you look at a random walk where with probability half, you actually stay where you are. And with probability half, you do the thing that you normally do with random walks. So with probability half, the walk stays at correct node. With probability half, you do a regular random walk. And this sort of somewhat complicated way of stating this theorem tells you, the way they analyze the random walk is, instead of looking at the time you're spending on a vertex, you're looking at the probability of covering a particular edge. Okay? Look at the stationary distribution that we calculated here, was degree over 2m. And then we calculated the expected amount of time it took to cross this edge was 2m. So in fact, in a random walk, if you look at a stationary distribution over edges, every edge has exactly the same probability. It's 1 over 2m. So it's 1 over 2m of going in each direction. So if you look at the random walk, in stationary distribution, you try to catch it, with probability 1 over 2m, it's going on one of the edges in one direction. It's amazing, meaning that the edges are completely, over the edges, it's completely uniform. So they look at the probability that you are actually spending time at an edge, okay, in either direction. And they say, they want to calculate, so in stationary distribution, if I look at the topmost k edges, okay, topmost k edges, what is the probability associated with the topmost k edges? Well, it's k over 2m, okay, in each direction. So they ask, how far am I from x over 2m for a given x? And that is the bound they prove, that you're far away from that, don't worry about the min, that factor, multiplied by 1 minus phi square over 2 to the power of t. You notice that it is very similar. We had lambda to the t, and here we have 1 minus phi square over t. It turns out that the lambda and 1 minus phi square are related. What is this phi square? Well, phi is what is called the conductance of the graph. And it's defined a little differently, but again, if you remember the expansion definition that I gave you, it's very similar. I look at the number of edges between S and V minus S, and I look at the minimum of the number of edges inside versus the number of vertices inside, and that's the conductance. We are going to look at this conductance later on, maybe today later and also tomorrow. So it measures basically the expansion of the graph. So what they basically said was that again, it's the same thing. If you have graphs with very high conductance, so if phi is large, so that number is closer to zero, so it will rapidly reduce errors. Okay? So phi is large means the conductance is large. Conductance is large means the number of edges, if you look at any set, the number of edges going out is quite high. So it sort of expands very well. And that gives you that. So one area where random walks have played an important role is in trying to find these cuts. Okay, so why are people interested in finding these cuts? Because if you look at it, cuts are where describe the bottleneck in a graph, right? If I find a set of vertices which has very few edges going out, then I know that's a bottleneck in the graph. So there is this very famous problem that has dominated. Has played a big role in approximation algorithms and optimization is what is called the sparsest cut problem. That is trying to find a cut that gives you the conductance. Okay? The cut that has the fewest edges leaving as a ratio of the number of edges inside. So one way to solve this sparsest cut problem is using linear programming rounding. all of you have seen versions of linear programming rounding, but these are more, so a little bit more sophisticated than what you might have seen, but there's an order log n approximation. But the best result known in this space is a rounding due to Arora Rao and Vazirani that uses semi-definite programming, something that we have not covered in this workshop, but that's something you should try to understand down the line, and it gives you a square root log n approximation. One thing about finding these small cuts, so why are we interested in finding these small cuts? Because the small cuts, so just one picture, if you have a graph and you find a small cut, there are very few edges here, then it sort of tells you that, oh, this graph breaks down into two nice clusters. That somehow these nodes are very well connected among themselves, these nodes are very well connected among themselves, and there is nothing going on. So this could, so finding small cuts, finding these cuts is a good way of finding clusters. So one way to find clusters is to solve the sparsest cut problem. But it's a very expensive way because you have to solve the LP or the SDP and it's too complicated. And this is essentially the last slide, what random walks give you is a very local way of calculating cuts. And it's really a beautiful idea. So let's suppose you're given, a big social network or the web graph. And from that, I want to extract all the pages that belong to IMSC or IIT Madras, right? So if you look at the web graph, you would notice that, oh, if I look at hone into this, then I would find that there are lots of edges within the IIT Madras setup, but there are few edges from this site to outside. So I'm looking for the smallest cut, in some sense, cuts that don't expand that much, that contain an IMSC or IIT Madras page. How do I find it? So here is a simple idea. Let's suppose I start from a vertex inside, and I do a random walk. Okay, but if I keep on doing a random walk for a long time, then I know that I will be somewhere else. But let's say I don't do it for a long time. I do it only for a short period of time. What do you think what will happen? Where will the random walk lie? Mostly inside the space, because if the cut is very small, it's very unlikely to go out. So the beautiful idea about local clustering is that the really nice beauty about it is you don't have to even look at the graph outside. You can really do completely local, and this is really, can be blazingly fast, whose time might only depend upon the size of the cluster you're trying to compute. So this is very useful in finding clusters in really large graphs when you really don't have the luxury to spend time to do computation over the whole graph. Okay, and there is some references there. I'll put all these references and give you a bibliography, but it uses the Lovaas-Simonovitz theorem, but since we have not covered it, we won't go with this anymore. Okay, so the takeaway messages from this first half is that we went through random walks and related processes, arise in several scenarios. They are very, very useful primitives for designing fast algorithms, yield effective and practical pseudo-random sources. If you really want to develop a better understanding, improve your understanding and use of tools from probability, Markov's inequality, Chernoff top bounds, martingales. We'll see a use of martingales hopefully tomorrow, and from spectral graph theory. Okay, so we'll stop and we'll reconvene in about half an hour. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Okay, so the second half of today's processes, percolation refers to the process by which some fluid or some flow spreads through a system. In fact, with the origins of this area called percolation theory, which is heavily studied in mathematics, and in fact for which we had a Fields Medal winner when we had in India, right? And Smirnov, who won it for analyzing percolation processes on triangular lattices and variations. Basically, percolation processes of the kinds are closely connected with random walks and variations of those processes. And for us, for computer scientists, they are of interest because they often seem to be useful in analyzing diffusion processes. Okay, so the outline is we will start off with going over a very classic result in branching processes. How many of you have seen analysis of branching processes? Okay, good. So it's a classic result, so this is not something that I'm going to cover that is new, but it's a very, 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 very useful tool, I feel, and very useful as thumb rules for trying to understand what is going on in a particular process. Then we will talk about percolation theory, epidemic spread in an infinite graph, and all of you, many of you are probably familiar with Erdős-Renyi random graphs. They are nothing but percolations on a particular kind of graph. So they're closely tied, and in fact you will see how sort of some of the ideas or at least some of the results from from percolation and branching percolate to Erdős-Renyi random graphs and so on. And we will talk about percolation and final graphs. So hopefully this will set the stage for more algorithmic material and that we will cover tomorrow. Okay. So before, so let me start off with this. So branching processes, these are natural probabilistic processes studied in mathematics, widely used for modeling the spread of diseases, viruses, innovation, etc. in networks. So the basic model of a branching process is the following. Let's say a disease originates at the root of an infinite tree. Okay, so imagine an infinite tree starting from a node and it just originates. And this tree is a k-ary tree. The degree of each vertex, the down degree, that is each parent has has k children. That's called the branching factor. And p is the probability of transmission along each edge of this graph, which is of this tree, which is completely independent of everything else that is going on. So the one question that really people in branching processes and even in fact we will continue to think about is, what is the probability that this thing will never stop? Okay, and you can see the connections with epidemics. Epidemics are when something spread and really are not under control, they never stop. So what is the probability that the disease persists indefinitely? So one of the first theorems we are going to see, and it's a fairly easy analysis, is that if the product is entirely captured by the product of the probability and the branching factor. If p times k is less than 1, then the probability is 0. If the p times k is greater than 1, then the probability is greater than 0. If p times k is equal to 1, then there are some things that you have to be a little careful about, but we won't look at that particular case. Okay, so that will be one of the first results we'll start off with. So this was assuming an infinite tree. So now the question is, okay, really, there were no dependencies, right? Once you have this, everything is going on independently, so that's sort of relatively easier to calculate. What if you make it, what if you think about the spread of the disease, but on an infinite graph? For example, let's say the infinite grid. So let's suppose I have an infinite grid, and each edge in this infinite grid is selected with the probability p. Okay? Actually an infinite graph, but for now let's assume this the grid, the two-dimensional grid. Each edge is selected with the probability p. Let's suppose p is 0. Then what's the graph that is selected?
Empty.
If p is 1, then it's the entire graph. So the question is, what is happening as p goes from 0 to 1? And in particular, you're interested in what is the probability that there is an infinite connected component, an infinite cluster in this grid. Okay? There is really an amazing result due to Kolmogorov. So one thing you might think is, oh, it's some number between 0 and 1. There is an amazing result due to Kolmogorov, it's called Kolmogorov 01 law, that for questions of this kind, where I'm asking the probability of there being an infinite connected component, there are only one of two answers. It's either 0 or 1. So when you think about this, it's a really somewhat very counterintuitive, that what happens is so if you want to plot here, this is P, this is probability of infinite component, what Kolmogorov 01 law says, we know that at p equal to 0 we are here, there is no infinite component. At p equals 1 we are here. Okay, Kolmogorov 01 law says that the picture, so you might think, oh well, it's some linear line between these two, but Kolmogorov 01 law says that your answer to this is this. That's the only possibility. Okay, this point, so this is a really, really interesting point to understand.
There only one such point.
And in for this particular process, there is only one such point. Yes. This is called the critical probability, and this is the term that's called phase transition. And it's probably of interest to almost every physicist working in roughly the same space. So physicists are constantly interested in phase transitions. Okay, so you might have heard the term phase transitions, which come up in lots of analysis of complex systems, sharp thresholds, which come up with lots of analysis of random graphs. That's exactly what they're talking about. Some phenomena that is not existent, and then boom, suddenly it becomes existent. And it seems to be very pervasive, and lots of interesting systems that we are working with, such sharp thresholds exist. Okay? Okay, so one of the questions that probably dominated at least several the interest of several mathematicians for over 30 years was really the question of what is the critical probability for the 2D grid. Okay. Any guesses? Okay, so that's half, and it actually, you can see that Harris proved it one direction in 60, and it took 20 years for Kesten to prove the other direction. Nowadays, there is a relatively accessible proof, which probably will take about, you can cover it in 2 or 3 days. We will try to do a proof of one direction just to show you how, of not the complete direction. It's not hard to see that the critical probability is between 1/3 and 2/3, and I will do the proof of critical probability is less than or equal to 2/3, and I will leave it as an exercise for you to do. It's at least 1/3, and it's not that hard to see using 1/3. There is a very nice book due to Bolabash and Riordan on percolation, which introduces a lot of interesting tools and lots of interesting inequalities. There is also a nice collection of notes by Bakhchi and Kirani on this topic from IIT Delhi. Okay, so percolation, the way I described it, I'm picking each edge with probability p, this is over an infinite graph. So that immediately suggests to you, okay, what if I work on a finite graph? And then if you think about the complete graph and I decide to pick each edge with probability, what do I get? The Erdős-Reni random graph model. So Erdős-Reni random graphs are nothing but percolation. The GNP model, what's called the GNP model, is nothing but percolation over the complete graph over n vertices. So Erdős-Reni in 59 and 60, and there is a huge amount of work since then by lots of people, including Knuth and even until recently work by Fries and Flaxman, and there is lots of interesting work there. They try to understand the critical probability and sharp threshold for various phenomena. So one of the first questions they wanted to understand was, again, as p equal to 0, the graph is empty. P equals 1, the graph is complete. As I keep increasing p, I want to know at what point do I get a connected component that captures a constant fraction of the whole graph. Intuitively, that is very similar to getting an infinite connected component in an infinite grid, for example. It's also very similar to getting an reaching an infinite number of nodes in the branching process down. So if you remember, the branching process rule was k times p should be 1. That's the threshold before you get something or the other. And it turns out the same kind of rule applies here, that the emergence of a giant component happens just around the time of 1 over n. I'm fudging some plus minus factors here, but at the time the probability is 1 over n, after that time, if the probability is even slightly more than 1 over n, you get a giant component. If the probability is even slightly less than 1 over n, not only don't you get any giant component, you get really tiny components. That's really the whole point about percolation, about these sharp threshold. We will prove the claim for connectivity, that p is theta ln n over n. We will prove that. Very beautiful result to Friedgood and Kalai, that every symmetric, so this property is not just true of emergence of giant components connectivity, these are just two properties. But if you look at any monotone property, okay, essentially any monotone property, it has a sharp threshold. Whatever monotone property you're interested in, there is some point of time until it was not present, and then suddenly it's present. Okay, and by monotone, I mean, for example, that the property, as you add more edges, if the property holds, then the property continues to hold. There is, since then, there has been work on percolation on specific classes of finite graphs, not just the complete graph, right? And again, you have lots of questions. At what probability will we have at least one connected component of size omega n? There are lots of open questions in this area, by the way, so there's not much work that has been done. There is a result due to Alone, Benjamini, and Stacey, who looked at percolation on uniform expanders, and they prove results that the probability that the uniform expanders contain more than one giant component tends to zero, and that's what happens in Elder-Schrenyi graphs as well. You basically get just one giant component and that's it. And they show that for high girth D-regular expander graphs, the critical probability for unique giant component is 1 over D minus 1. Again, the D is, you can see the connection with branching processes, but there are lots of open questions in this area. Okay, so in general, so I'm going to go over the results that I talked about, namely the branching process results, the percolation result, and the Erdős-Schrenyi random graph result. But in general, the work in this area in looking at these random graphs, in study of complex networks and systems, many properties undergo phase transitions. This corresponds to critical probabilities and sharp thresholds in random graphs and percolation. So ER random graphs provide a useful model for developing analytical tools. But in practice, you have to come up with variations of the models. And there is a huge amount of work in this space. There is work on coming up with random graph models that satisfy a certain specified degree distribution. There's original work by Bender Canfield, but then there is a lot more work by Fan Cheng and others. There's a widely used preferential attachment model due to Barabasi and Albert. There is work on power law graph models, due to Ilo, Chung, and Liu, which talk about, again, posit some power law distribution over the degrees of the vertices. We will go over some examples of one example of a small world network model due to Kleinberg tomorrow when we talk about navigability of graphs. But in terms of what you want to take away from what we're going to do today, I guess I'll go over this at the end of what I cover. But basically, think about for many of the trying to understand some phenomena about networks, developing models, trying to analyze how you would the phenomena developing those models, understanding critical probabilities, understanding phase transitions and threshold phenomena. Okay, all right. So can we switch on the light? Okay, so we will do three results. One is the branching process analysis. Okay, let's do that first. And that will suggest some ideas for the percolation, and then we will move on. Okay, so let's suppose that a disease originates at this vertex and it has k, yes, then something else happens. So we have this infinite tree going down. Okay? Okay, so I want to know what is the probability that this goes on forever. Okay? So let me focus on my attention on a particular level, I. Okay. So within a particular level I, let me look at a particular vertex V. So what is the probability that V is reached in this branching process? What is the probability that V is reached in this branching process? Okay, all the edges to that have to be selected. So what would that be equal to? So the number of edges is, so it's, so let me call this level I, level 0, level 1 and so on. So this is level I. So level I means there are I edges. So it's basically P to the I. Right? Clear? That the probability that V is reached is P to the I. Okay? Okay, that's fine. Okay, so what I want to calculate is the probability that level I is reached. That is what I want to calculate. Okay? All right, so how do I calculate the probability? I want to, and let's call this Q sub I. Okay? How do I calculate this probability? I know this, okay, let's do a easier calculation first. The probability that V is reached is P to the I. What is the expected number of vertices at level I reached? What's that equal to? K to the I times P to the I. So you can see the importance of K times P, right? If K times P is bigger than 1, then this expectation is at least bigger than 1. If K times P is less than 1, then this expectation is actually less than 1. Okay, but now I want to calculate Q sub I, which is the probability that level I is reached. How do I calculate this? Okay, so one way to do it is, let me just look at the root. And now I can view this as a branching process at off level I minus 1, right? And I can view this as level I minus 1, view this as level I minus 1. Okay, so I view this as, so the probability that I will reach something here is equal to, or rather the probability that I will not reach anybody here let's see which is the better way to calculate it. What is the probability that I will reach some vertex here? Just this portion. Well, I have to pick this, which is probability P. Then from here I have to reach somebody there, which is Q of I minus 1. So QI equals, okay, so sorry. I did it that way. So the probability that I reach somebody here is P times Q I minus 1. What's the probability that I reach somebody here? P times Q I minus 1. What's the probability that I reach somebody here? P times Q minus 1. What's the probability that I reach somebody in one of these? So what is QI? Well, it is 1 minus P QI minus 1 to the power of K. Okay? Right? Okay, so it's 1 minus p q to the I minus 1 to the power of k, good. So now, so in general I have this formula now that QI is 1 minus QI minus 1 power of K. So if I treat Q star is the probability of an inf of reaching infinite number of levels, then you can see that Q star equals 1 minus of k. Right? Okay. Okay, so what do we do with this? So let's try to view this more pictorially. So essentially Q star is the fixed point of the equation FQ equals 1 minus PQ to the power of K. Okay? That's basically what Q star is. It's the fixed point of that equation, 1 minus PQ to the power of K. Okay. So if let's try to see what this, so this is a function on Q, right? So I can look at this Q and look at this F of Q. Okay, so when Q equal to 0, what is F of Q? 0. When Q equals 1, what is F of Q? 1, which is 1 minus P to the F of Q. Okay. All right. So if you look at this, so let's try to look at this function a little bit more closely. Okay. Let's try to see what happens to this function as Q changes. Okay. So what is df dq? Well, it is k times 1 minus pq to the k minus 1 times p. I think this minus and this minus, yeah, that's kind of cancelled. So it's an increasing function. It takes its maximum value to be 1 minus 1 minus p to the q, and okay. So what, so in fact, if you look at d square f by dq, we get k minus 1 p into 1 minus pq to the k minus 2, I guess, p square. Now we get a negative, right? Okay, so it's a So what's happening here is it's a concave function, and this one is correctly, yeah. Okay, good. So what we want to find out is what is the fixed point of this equation, and whether we can learn anything from we want to find out whether Q star is positive. So the question really is Q star greater than 0? Okay, that's really the question. Okay, so let's try to understand this. So I've drawn this picture. This is, by the way, less than 1. So if I draw the line x equals y, I get something like this. Okay, so this is the line x equals y. Y equals x line. Okay, and then this is, all right. So let's try to see what is Q star. So Q star is, as we know, is the fixed point of this equation. So what we can do is we can start from a point We can start from q equals whatever value. You can keep computing f of q, then apply the value again on f of q, and then apply again and again, and then see where this goes. Okay. Okay. So I've drawn this picture like this, meaning it may not exactly look there like this, but let's see what happens. So let's suppose I start from this. So what is this point? This is fq equals q. So this point is q star. This is what I want to find out. Okay. Now, I noticed that, look at this. This is a concave function, right? So it crosses here and crosses like this. Is this picture always accurate? This picture is accurate, meaning the way I've drawn it, so this is one of the problems with pictures, is that they could be wrong. This picture may never occur if at the time you are going up, you always stay below this line. So here is picture one, here is a different picture. See that? So there are two possible pictures, this one or this one. There is no other possibility. So these are really the two possibilities that give us the two situations. So in this possibility, q star is positive. In this possibility, q star is zero. So let's try to calculate, when is this two possibilities there? So how do you express the possibilities? Exactly. So if df by dq is more than 1 at 0, then you get this possibility. If df by dq is less than 1, less than or equal to 1 at 0, then you get this possibility. Okay. So we are looking at this. Kp times 1 minus pq to the power of k minus 1. Okay. So df by dq equals kp times 1 minus pq minus 1, and at q equal to 0, this is equal to kp. So if kp is, if kp is less than or equal to 1, okay, if kp is less than or equal to 1, then your q star is 0. There is a little thing you have to be a little careful about, and I will mention that momentarily. That's not exactly true. So it's certainly true. If kp is, and if you start from here, let's say, go here, hit here. See, I didn't draw it. This way. Okay, when kp equals 1, then it's a little tricky, because when kp equals 1, there is one possibility that this curve might actually be exactly the same as the line. And that's the possibility when k is 1 and p is 1. If k is 1 and p is 1, then you will go on forever, right? But any other situation, it's going to not go into an infinite component. It's going to stay as a finite component. Okay? Okay, so this is a very, very useful rule of thumb that you can actually keep in mind for many such phenomena, that when you're trying to see whether something is going to explode or stay controlled, you can capture it by the branching factor, the product of the branching factor and the probability with which each of those branches are occurring. Okay? Okay, so we are going to use this, not exactly this idea, but this idea can be used to do our second percolation of on 2D infinite grid. So you have a 2D infinite grid, and I said that the critical probability at which we have an infinite component is half. In fact, at less than equal to half, you have no infinite component. At greater than half, you always have an infinite component. We are going to prove PC is at least 1/3 less than equal to 2/3. Okay? This actually I'm going to leave it as an exercise for you folks to try to do. Prove that PC is at least 1/3. Okay, and it's not that hard. You can see the analysis that we are trying to do for the less than equal to 2/3 is not easy, and we'll go over this calculation. Okay, so and it actually introduces, looks at this concept of duality, which you already have seen in planar graphs, so it's actually a useful way to reinforce that as well. Okay, so what are we looking at? I'm looking at the 2D grid with percolation being, with the probability of edge being added into the grid with probability at least 2/3. Okay, so first thing to observe, the really nice thing to observe about percolation is the following, about the 2D grid is the following. Okay, let's say I picked, these are the edges that I selected. I suppose those are the edges that I selected. Then I didn't select this edge, and let me also add a few more. This edge I selected, and let's say this. Okay. I can look at the dual of this planar graph. What is the dual of the grid? Another grid where the vertices are located where? In the middle of this. Okay. Now, it seems natural for me to do the following. Whenever I pick an edge here, I assume that I don't pick this edge in the dual. Whenever I didn't pick this edge, I assume that I pick this edge in the dual. And so on. Okay. So percolation, any percolation process on the 2D grid immediately yields a percolation process on the dual, which is under the 2D grid. What is the probability of edge selection in the dual? 1 minus p. So because if I'll pick this edge exactly when this edge is not picked. But of course these are not independent processes. These are in fact exactly correlated, right, in some ways. Good. Okay. So very good. So let's suppose I'm looking at a vertex V. I want to find out what is the probability that this vertex is let's say I want to find out the following. I'm looking at this event that V has no path of length, say event that V cluster is of size at most M. Suppose I'm looking at this event, that V's cluster is of size at most M. Then, what can I say about, how do I express this event? V's cluster is of size of at most M. That means if I look at V's edges, the edges that contain V that are connected, it might look like this. Okay, these are the ones that are selected. But at some point they stop spreading and then the cluster stops. What does that mean in the dual? The fact that I had these edges, let me draw a few more. Okay, so let's suppose this is the cluster that I saw in the original grid. What picture can you imagine that it, can I say about the dual? Well, dual has an infinite, not necessarily. Pardon? So the fact that there is no edge here must be that there is an edge here. The fact that there is no edge here, that means there must be an edge in here. There must be an edge here. There must be an edge here, must be an edge here, must be an edge here. This must exist in the dual. People see that? Good. And so if, let's say, if the and you can come up with a bound on the size of this cycle. Actually, it's not that hard to come up with a bound on the size of the cycle, because notice that the size of the cycle, it's going up and down, and here of course it's going up here and so on. But you can give a bound on the size of the cycle also. Implies there exists a relatively small cycle. That in the dual, that contains V in the interior. Okay, so we are going to use this insight to argue that if basically as P becomes very large, the probability of this cycle existing becomes small or large? Small, because it's 1 minus p. So the probability of this becomes small. So we're going to argue that as p becomes larger and larger, the probability that there is a cycle that comes in the dual that sort of constrains v becomes smaller and smaller. Okay? This is actually also the final proof for getting pc equals half, but there it's a lot more complicated because here we will take advantage of loose bounds, and there you have to just do it much more carefully. But let's see this. Okay, so the proof is going to go like this, that let's pick some M, consider box. Of side length M around the vertex V. Okay? So we consider this is a box of side length M around V. So consider a box of side length M around V. So this is V, this is the okay. So let me define an event EM, which is the event that all edges in this box BM are selected. let me consider the event fm as being that there exists a cycle in the dual that completely contains BM. Okay? There exists a cycle in the dual that completely envelops BM. EM is every edge in BM is selected. Okay? So I claim, and let me fix some M, it doesn't matter what this M is. I claim that if EM and FM complement implies V is in an infinite cluster. Everybody agree with that? So if for V not to exist in an infinite cluster, I suppose, let's suppose all the edges in this box were included. Once all the edges in this box were included, for V not to be an infinite cluster, it must be the case that there must be some cycle in the dual that envelops this. And if it turns out that there is no such cycle in the dual that envelops it, then it must be the case that V is an infinite cluster. Okay? Okay, so we're going to calculate. Notice that EM and FM are independent events because what is going on inside is completely independent of what is going on outside. So let's look at what is going on outside. Notice that EM is about the grid, FM is about the dual. Okay, but they are related, of course. Okay, so let's look at a cycle that, so this is the box. Let's look at a cycle around this box. How many edges must this cycle have, at least? At least 4m, right? Okay, good. But, all right, so that's very good. How many cycles are there? So let's pick K. Let's look at a K edge cycle. Okay, so let's fix a K edge cycle. What is the probability of the K edge cycle existing in the dual? What is its probability? That one particular K edge cycle exists in the dual. 1 minus P raised to the K. How many such K edge cycles are there? Well, let's do the following. This is M. Let's pick V as the center. Let me draw a line here. Then this is a point. Okay. Then for this this point, let me fix a particular point here. And let me look at the number of cycles starting from this point that end here. Okay. How many directions can I go? Notice that I could go here, I could go here, I could go here. So there are, let's say, four directions for the first one. So there are four choices for my next hop. Once I go here, how many choices do I have for this? Three. Once I go there, how many choices do I have for this? 3. So you have 3 choices, and so on. How many times am I going? K times. So the number of cycles is less than equal to, how many choices do I have for the starting point? Well, so I'm going to always start on this line, okay? So I'm keeping the, so I'm always going to start on this line, but if this is already M, okay, if I go very far out, then I will be actually picking a really long cycle before I come back, right? So I have about M to play with, otherwise I will just come back. So you have sort of M choices or 2M choices, but number of cycles is less than equal to, sorry, I'm looking at a length of size K, so at most K choices there. It's a crude bond, but doesn't matter. So it's at most K times 4 choices for the first one, 3 for the rest. Okay? So the probability that any, so the now I want to say the probability of FM complement is, or rather probability of FM, let's say, probability of FM is less than equal to summation K going from 4M to infinity of K times 4, 3 to the K minus 1 times 1 minus P to the K. Okay? Everybody clear with this? Okay. By the way, I will prove this actually for P greater than. Okay. We can actually do it for greater than equal to also, but I'll prove it for greater than. Okay. So notice that this, so let's say we ignore K for now, for the moment. Then what do we have? 1 minus P is at most 1 third. So that times that, we actually get a number strictly less than 1. So that is a geometrically decreasing series. So that bound is strictly less than 1. With the K, if you have done calculations like these, you notice that that's not actually going to change anything. Because not only does summation P to the K converge if K is small, if P is smaller than 1, summation K P to the K or K minus 1 also converges if summation, if P is smaller than 1. Okay, so this can actually be, you can set these things up so that this is strictly less than 1. So if this is strictly less than 1, probability of EM and FM, by the way, to make this calculation strictly less than 1, the only thing you will play around with is M. Okay, you have to just make M large enough so that that's strictly less than 1. So probability of EM and FM complement, you can make it strictly greater than 0. Why? Probability of EM, what is the probability of EM? All these edges are included. What's that probability? P to the M choose 2, right, or something like that. I don't know, M square. Something like P to the M square. That's a tiny value, but it's still positive, it's not 0. So you get probability of this and FM complement is strictly greater than 0. So if the probability of these two things is strictly greater than 0, then now you get that the probability that V is an infinite cluster is strictly greater than 0. And this V is an arbitrary V, imagine the origin. So probability that the origin is strictly is in an infinite cluster is strictly greater than 0 implies that the probability that there is an infinite cluster is strictly greater than 0. But we know that the probability of there is an infinite cluster is either 0 or 1. Then it had actually better be 1. Okay? Greater than 0 implies probability V in infinite cluster is strictly greater than 0 implies probability infinite. Okay, so the thing to notice here is that, and you, that this, when you try to do this exercise, you will see basically where the why we are getting, where we are able to prove this for 1 over 3 is effectively we are, when we are doing this calculation for these number of cycles, we are ignoring the fact that things come and meet. We are just viewing this as sort of a branching. And if you remember, and if you're doing branching with k equals 3, what is the threshold of P? 1 over 3 in the branching process. And that is effectively why we're getting this 1/3, 2/3 bound. But in trying to prove this for the whole grid much more carefully, you have to take into account these correlations because things happen, since edges come and meet, you have these correlations. So basically, in trying to prove this, one of the main tools is what are called correlation inequalities. Okay, basically, if A, essentially, it says, and it's almost obvious. If A and B are positively correlated, then the probability of A intersection B is greater than or equal to probability A times probability of B. Okay. And what the challenge is really to identify, in trying to give the whole proof for PC equals half, in trying to identify the set of events you will try to analyze and really look at the relationship between the dual and the primal to get absolutely a tight bound at which interesting things happen. Okay. And that will require a lot more machinery, so I'm going to skip that. But you can there are these. I'll just give some names of inequalities that you might actually want to look at. So there is this thing which is widely used, the FKG inequality, which is nothing but another way of saying this. Okay, so you might want to look at this, sometimes also called Harris's lemma. And similarly, there is this thing called the four functions theorem. They're all versions of these correlation qualities. Okay, good. So let's move to looking at these threshold phenomena in random graphs. So you have, let's suppose we work with the GNP random graph model. Okay. And so something that we are not going to prove, that the threshold for a giant component is P approximately 1 over n. What's the threshold for connectivity? This is ln n over n. Okay? We are going to see a weaker bound, but we're going to argue that if P is that for connectivity this, and in fact we are going to argue that when it does become connected, you actually get an expander. Okay, we'll also prove that. Okay, so let's try to see this. So let's say you have, let's fix P. So we want this graph to be connected, so we're trying to see as P increases, if P is 0 then the graph is disconnected, there's nothing there, if P is 1 then it's the complete graph, so as P increases at some point it gets connected. So I want to prove that if P is less than C times ln n over n for some C, which we can choose appropriately, then the graph is disconnected with high probability. Okay, so how do I prove that the graph is disconnected when P is very small? No, it's not very small, it is small, but so one of the challenges in looking at this is that what happens at slow, so notice that when P is 1 over n, right? Notice that 1 over n is really much, much smaller than this. At that point, we already have a giant component. But why is it not connected? Because there are vertices floating around which are actually quite isolated, which are not even connected to this component. So one way to try to understand when a graph is disconnected is to look at isolated vertices. So let's look at a probability that a vertex is isolated. Okay, what's the probability that a particular vertex is isolated? Anybody? 1 minus p to the power of? So let's say if p is c ln n over n, and let's say divided by, okay, what is this? 1 minus c ln n over n to the power of n over c ln n. Okay, let me leave it like that. This quantity is something close to 1 over e. So this whole quantity is something close to 1 over n to the c. Okay? Okay? If you have this, then what is the probability that no vertex is isolated? Okay, so the probability for one vertex being isolated is one over, did I did it correctly here? Okay, so what do I do after this point? Okay, probability but the problem with this union bound is I get a less than equal to, right? What do I get? The probability that exists a vertex is isolated is less than equal to n over n to the c, but that's not sufficient, right? So I cannot do it that. I'm trying to just to find out. I'm trying to give a lower bound and the probability that it is disconnected.
Right.
Okay.
Even this could mean.
So if there exists a vertex that is isolated, then you know that the graph is disconnected.
That is true.
So that's why I don't want less than equal to. I want a bound of greater than equal to.
If there is, V is isolated, but
if V is isolated, so basically, I at least have the following, right? Probability G is disconnected is greater than equal to the probability that G has, actually let me put it this way, probability that G is connected is less than equal to probability no isolated vertices. Right? So probability that there is no isolated vertices, one approach would be to say a union bound, to say that, oh, this is less than equal to summation over all vertices, probability V is isolated. But that's not going to work. Sorry. That's not going to work. Why is that? Because the probability that B is isolated is quite small, so I cannot just add it over. This will not give a, will not be enough. No. We are looking at probability that no but isolated vertex is. Oh, but either case, all I'm saying is this is not, it's, it won't help, yeah, that's all, maybe it's 1 minus actually or whatever, okay, so let's try to see what we can do. So, yeah, right. First, this is a distance 2 would be independent, but how do we get that? We know that the probability that V is isolated is this one. We can try to, so one strategy is you look at expected number of isolated vertices is what? Something like n over n to the c. And the point is you can make your C very small. That's the point, right? You will make your C very small So n to the c is very small. So 1 over n to the c. So you think of c as being epsilon, actually. That's probably a better way to think about it. Think of c as being epsilon, which is tiny. So it's basically n to the 1 minus epsilon. So now what do we do? So we have this expectation bound. Then, as was suggested, we can try to use Chebyshev's inequality. Okay. And for bounding Chebyshev's inequality, what you have to do is you have to calculate the expectation of x minus, where x is the number of isolated vertices. And we know that expectation of x is n to the 1 minus epsilon. We look at the expectation of x minus mu square. Okay, we look at expectation of x minus mu square. Okay, so we'll try to calculate that right now. So there are several ways to calculate it. So let's try to just do it in a more brute force way. This is the expectation of x square minus 2 mu x plus mu square. So this is expectation of x square minus mu square, right? Because expectation of x is mu. Okay, so we have to calculate expectation of x square. Expectation of x square is what? Is the expectation of summation xi whole square, where xi is an indicator random variable whether I is isolated. Okay, so that's the indicator random variable whether I is isolated. So expectation of the summation xi square is summation over I of expectation of xi square plus 2 summation ij, I not equal to j, of expectation of xi xj. Okay? What is this? This is just mu. What about this? Expectation of xi times xj. This is what we are looking at. What is the probability that two particular vertices are simultaneously isolated? So what's that probability equal to? What's the probability that this is isolated and this is isolated? Well, probability that this is isolated and this is isolated is equal to p to the power of, or rather 1 minus p to the power of, how many edges? N minus 1, N minus 1, one of them is common. So 2N minus 3, right? Yeah, okay. So 1 minus P to the power of 2N minus 3. 1 minus P is again 1 minus C ln N over N, the power of that. So, but the point is these are virtually independent, right? For all practical purposes, they are independent except for this one single edge. So this quantity is very, very close to the expectation of xi times expectation of xj, which is mu square. So this whole quantity is very close to mu plus 2 n choose 2 into whatever probability you have for the isolated vertex for one of them, which is times 2. So what was the 1 by n to the c square. Okay. Okay, so basically when you do this calculation, you get that this n times this is nothing but the expectation, so that's mu. So this is actually very, very close to mu square and 2. So so effectively what you calculate for this is very close to mu. Mu plus mu square. There is one thing that is missing here. 2 choose. Because xi squared is the same as xi, because it's 0, 1 variable, so that's just mu. Let me just make sure that I did this correctly. This. That's correct, okay. So one more nc, so this times this is nothing but mu, so it's mu square, so it's roughly close to mu. If you apply Chebyshev's inequality, you get so probability that x minus mu is greater than or equal to some alpha is less than or equal to expectation of x minus mu square divided by alpha square. Expectation of x minus mu square is roughly mu divided by alpha square. So if you choose your alpha to be, let's say, half of mu, okay, so you basically get square equals mu. Mu is n to the power of 1 minus epsilon. So we get, okay, there are lots of approximations here, so it's a rough calculation. But basically you guarantee that the number of isolated vertices is close to n to the 1 minus epsilon with probability 1 minus 1 over n to the n minus epsilon. Okay, so I'll try to quickly do the other direction. This is one direction. The other direction is that it is connected. Okay. So how do you prove something is connected? So in order to prove something is disconnected, we looked at isolated vertices. How do you prove that something is connected? Yes, but we only proved a lower bound. So this is where I wrote that. So probability that it is disconnected is greater than or equal to the probability that there are isolated vertices. So this is fine. Okay. So what if P is less than equal? Okay, how do you prove that? Okay, so that is the case where we are done. So now I want to look at P is greater than or equal to some constant D times ln n by n. Okay, where I will choose my D sufficiently large. How do I make sure that the graph is connected? For if the graph is not connected, then there will be a cut. So that means all we will argue is if the graph is connected, if we argue that every cut has some vertex, has some edge across it, then it is connected. What is the challenge in this? How many cuts are there? 2 to the n. So you have to be very, very careful in how you do this. Okay, but one can handle this. So let me look at a cut. S, V minus S. Okay, how many edges in the complete graph are there across this? Let me look at S of size k. Okay, so how many possible edges are there? K times n minus k. If my probability is p, what is the expected number of edges crossing this? P into k. What is p? P is d ln n by n. This is the expected. Okay? Now let me assume that this is the smaller side. So how large is n minus k? At least n over 2. Thank you. Yeah. At least n over 2. So this is at least d ln n k divided by 2. Okay? Good. Notice that k is at least 1. So this is at least this. So this is the expected number of edges crossing the cut. Okay? I want to go from this. This is only the expectation. That's not enough. I want to show that with very good probability this is the case. How do I bound the probability? How do I get that with very high probability I will have enough edges crossing the cut? I will use it. We can use Chernoff bounds. So what we do is probability that number of edges crossing is less than equal to, let's say, half of this. Is less than equal to e to the minus. This is the version of Chernoff bound where we're going to use, where we look at the mean square, the delta square, is that half square into the mean, which is d ln n to k. Now for d sufficiently large, if my d is sufficiently large, so notice that this is e to the ln n. E to the ln n is k, is n. If my d is sufficiently large, I can make sure that this is at least n to the minus 2k, let's say. Okay? How many cuts are there of size k n minus k? At most n choose k. N choose k is at most n to the k. So n to the k, and it is far less than n to the minus 2k. So now I apply a union bound. Probability that there exists some cut that is disconnected without an edge. This is less than or equal to n to the k, summation over all k, n to the k divided by 1 over n to the 2k. This is equal to summation over all k greater than or equal to 1, 1 over n to the k. This is strictly less than or equal to 1 over 2 over n. Okay, you can verify that. Okay, I also had promised to do the expander calculation, but I don't think I would have time to do that. So I think at this point, I'll just sort of wrap up and then I will give the exercises and then we can talk more during the afternoon. So the point is, I think if you be wanting to work in this area of trying to analyze complex network phenomena, which is becoming a pretty hot area in trying to understand various properties of graphs, looking at what kind of structures emerge in graphs, looking at how diffusion of information happens in graphs. The things you have to understand is this notion of critical probability, sharp thresholds, what kind of techniques are used to analyze that, and there are some rule of thumb calculations you can get from branching processes and looking at the infinite situation to get some good ideas. Then you have to understand random graph models. There is a large collection of models starting from ER, from Edish-Renyi, many motivated by real observations. The aim, of course, is to explain observed phenomena and predict future properties. They don't always do that. A lot of these are sort of half-baked and half-cooked, but there is something interesting that is going on. In terms of tools, we have already used some Chernoff type bounds. Here, you have to understand correlations very well, and there are lots of good correlation inequalities that handle dependence upon among random variables. And the physicists actually use other methods, including methods based on generating functions, with which they are very handy. We didn't see any of that, but for analyzing branching processes and for percolation, they seem to be very quick at getting a very good sense of what is going on by using generating function techniques, but that's also useful to keep in mind. Okay, so we're going to just end by just going over some problems. I'm going to state, I don't know, 3 or 4 problems, and then we will throw at you. And I'll also point out which problems I think are easier, which problems are harder. Of course, if you have seen these problems, then so this is the balls and bins calculation. Okay, n balls uniformly at random into n bins. One, prove maximum load is order n with high probability. Okay. More difficult is prove that maximum load is omega okay, the C is some constant that you can play with. So this, I would say, is easy. This, I would say, is difficult if you have not seen this before. Okay? One. Problem two. For complete graph, calculate the second largest eigenvalue lambda that we did, and also calculate the cover time. Okay, I think I would say both of these are should be relatively easy exercises. Problem three. For percolation on 2D grid, prove PC is greater than or equal to 1 over 3. And this should also be easy. Prove that GNP with P equals theta ln n and yields an expander. I'll call this sort of medium difficulty. It's not. Just write one more. And this the last problem I'm going to describe is kind of a precursor to what we're going to do tomorrow. rumor spreading in a general graph. Okay, so the setup here is, let's suppose a rumor originates at a particular node, initially rumor originates at a node, some node. Repeatedly, the following thing happens. Repeatedly, each node in each step, let me write this, in each step, each node that has the rumor spreads it to one neighbor chosen uniformly at random. Okay, so this is the process starting from a node. Every step, every node that knows the rumor picks one of its neighbors at random and spreads it to that node. This is a clean, simple way of dissemination of information. Prove that rumor spreading, this process covers all nodes in order n log n steps with high probability. Okay, I will call this, maybe it's hard, it's not that hard, I will say it's hard, but I think it's a good exercise for all of you to think about it, because in fact there is a paper that has a result like this. So just to get a sense for how papers could be written, and of course it may be difficult to write a paper based on a result like this right now, but some of these ideas is just to think of the problem correctly, you can often solve it. Yes?
How is it different from cover time in a non-regular graph?
How is it different from cover time in a non-regular graph? Very good question. So notice that a cover time, think of the cover time as where the rumor is moving. The random walk is a rumor moving around. Here, once a node has the rumor, it always has the rumor. Okay? So in the first step, node 1 has the rumor. In that step, the node 1 sends it to one of its neighbors, spreads the rumor to one of its neighbors. Now both the nodes have the rumor. So in the second step, each of them selects a random neighbor. In the third step, okay? Just to get an intuition, what you might want to do is pick some specific graphs and see how long this takes to spread, and then try to get some intuition based on that. Okay? Okay, I think we'll stop, so we have lunch, and
yes.
Between 2 and 4, I'll be generally around here, so if you have any questions, you can certainly, clarifications about those questions, and then 3:30, there is tea here. Before we will begin. We'll hear, right?
Yeah,
this is okay. Okay, so I really hope to see all of you at 4:00.